Good afternoon. I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. Ukraine rejects Russia's proposal for humanitarian corridors, calling the offer propaganda. Philippine economic managers recommend a nationwide shift to COVID alert level 1 to cushion the possible impact of the war in Ukraine on the local economy. And President Rodrigo Duterte appoints National Commission on Muslim Filipinos Secretary Isaydamen Pangarungan as the new Commission on Elections chairman. Welcome to the program. For those watching online, thanks for joining us. News now, efforts to implement humanitarian corridors in Ukraine bogging down. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky rejects Russia's proposal to establish humanitarian corridors and allow civilians to leave Ukrainian cities. Zelensky describes the proposal as plain propaganda since the corridors lead to Russia and its ally Belarus. United Nations members sounding the alarm over the rapidly deteriorating humanitarian crisis in Ukraine.
We need Russia's firm, clear, public, and unequivocal commitment to allow and facilitate immediate, unhindered humanitarian access for humanitarian partners in Ukraine. Very specifically, we call for the Russian Federation to agree to and honor in good faith Ukrainian proposals for time-bound humanitarian safe passage in specific agreed-upon locations. Ukrainian cities are under siege, under relentless Russian shelling. Hospitals are running out of supplies, food is dwindling, and civilian casualties are mounting while the most vulnerable group those with disabilities, the elderly, children, continue to bear the brunt of suffering.
The top diplomats of Russia and Ukraine set to hold another round of talks in Turkey Thursday after a third meeting ended with no positive developments. In an interview with Reuters, Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov said Moscow will immediately end its military operations if Kyiv meets several conditions it has laid out. The demands include Ukraine stopping its own military action, changing its constitution to enshrine neutrality, acknowledging Crimea as a Russian territory, and recognizing Donetsk and Luhansk as independent states. But Ukraine wants direct talks between President Volodymyr Zelensky and Russia's Vladimir Putin. Despite presenting efforts to help civilians, Russia is stepping up its indiscriminate assault on various Ukrainian regions. Two fires broke out at oil depots in Ukraine following Russian airstrikes. There were no reported casualties or injuries. Huge explosions are also being reported in southern Ukraine as Russian troops continue their attempt to capture the entire Black Sea coast. Fears are growing. Thousands of Ukrainians could die in the coming days if urgent relief does not arrive soon. For those who were able to leave the besieged country, they're calling on world powers to help rescue their embattled homeland.
As a flood of Ukrainian refugees fleeing a Russian invasion pours over the borders into neighboring nations, the people bring with them harrowing stories of hardship.
We stayed for a week near Kyiv. We thought it would be safer there than in Kyiv. But our town was bombed. We fled from there. We saw many cars left on the road, a lot of bombed cars. We were escaping to Kyiv, but now the situation in Kyiv is also scary because a few days ago they started bombing Kyiv, and it is very unsafe there.
Yana, who declined to give her surname, spoke to Reuters after crossing into Romania on Monday. She's one of an estimated 1.7 million civilians displaced by the Russian onslaught. And that number could just be the beginning. Here's the European Union's foreign policy chief.
If the bombings continue like this, if they continue to bomb cities in an indiscriminate manner, we can expect 5 million migrants. Well, not migrants. We can't call them migrants. These are exiled people, people who seek to escape the war.
Far too many are children. At a train station in Przemyśl in southeastern Poland, volunteers waited to greet youngsters, some sent without parents, to escape the fighting. In a shelter in the nearby town Medyka, a refugee named Olena, who didn't give her last name, huddled in tents and begged the nations of NATO to enforce a no-fly zone over her country to protect the people from Russian airstrikes.
Every Ukrainian just hopes that NATO will close the sky for us. Because we are ready to fight and we are ready to protect us from tanks, from artillery, from Grad rockets. But we are not able to protect our sky. We only beg God to protect the sky because NATO is just watching but doesn't do anything for us. We beg for protection.
Poland, which has the largest Ukrainian community in Central Europe, has received more than 1 million Ukrainian refugees since the conflict began. The fighting has created the largest wave of refugees in Europe since the Second World War.
More Filipinos evacuated from Ukraine have arrived in Manila. 21 Filipinos, all crew members of bulk carrier MVS Breeze, arrived at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Tuesday morning. They requested repatriation due to the worsening situation in Ukraine. This is the third batch of repatriates from Ukraine. More Filipinos are expected to travel back home after the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department raised the alert level over Ukraine to 4. This means the DFA will enforce the mandatory evacuation of Filipinos in Ukraine. They will be assisted by the Philippine Embassy in Poland. Despite the mandatory evacuation, some Filipinos are choosing to stay in Ukraine. Among them, a Filipino worker married to a Ukrainian national. She says she cannot simply pack her bags and leave her family behind. She also shares basic commodities are running out in the capital, Kyiv, where they are currently living.
So far, meron pa po kaming tubig, pero yung gamot po ng maintenance ng inlo ko, wala na po kasi sirado po yung mga pharmacy dito. Pagkain, mahirapan din po yung paghanap kasi yung malapit na mga maliliit na store namin dito, either sirado na siya or wala na siyang stock. Kailangan namin pumunta sa medyo malalayo, pero risky po siya.
Back here at home, Philippine economic managers are recommending a nationwide shift to COVID alert level 1 to cushion the possible effects of the Russia-Ukraine conflict on the economy. Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez says, while the war does not have a direct impact on the Philippines, the economy may incur what he calls collateral damage.
It is as if we are hit by a ricocheting bullet. These indirect shocks are likely to be felt through four major channels: the commodity market, the financial market, investments, and the impact on our fiscal health. I would like to emphasize that we do not expect this crisis to last very long. However, there may be some lingering effects. We have seen similar crises in the past, such as the Gulf War in 1990, the Asian financial crisis in 1997, the oil price shock of 2008, and also the first Russia-Ukraine conflict in 2014. And we have weathered all of these crises very well.
The government's economic team is suggesting 14 measures to alleviate the impact of the crisis. Among them, opening all schools for in-person classes to increase domestic economic activity and doubling the fuel subsidy program for public utility vehicle drivers to 5 billion pesos.
While we cannot prevent the risk from coming from the global perspective, we can strengthen our domestic economy to provide the people with more jobs and opportunities.
As Russia invades Ukraine, some young social media users are experiencing the conflict from the front lines on TikTok, in yet another example of the platform's role in bringing news to the Gen Z audience. Take a look.
As Russia invades Ukraine, some young social media users are experiencing the conflict from the front lines on TikTok. Ukrainian influencers uploaded videos of people crying in windowless bomb shelters, explosions blasting, and missiles streaking across the country's cities. The conflict, which Russia calls a special operation, is the latest example of the central role TikTok plays in bringing news to the Gen Z audience. The app has become so influential that Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky appealed to the, quote, TikTokers as a group that could help end the conflict. Some influencers, like 18-year-old Alina Volik, have answered the call.
During the first days of war, I wasn't even watching TikTok, and I didn't think about posting videos there. But then I just realized that this is unreal. And I was watching news all day long. I couldn't leave my phone, and I decided to make my video and to show people what it's like to live in Ukraine. Those photos that I edit in my video, like emergency backpack, sealed windows, I initially took these pictures for the memory and I wasn't going to post it. But then I collected it in one video, which has 14 million views right now on TikTok.
TikTok boasts 1 billion active monthly users. Its algorithm is known for serving trending content even if users do not follow certain people. It's a feature that allows topics to quickly go viral. Other Ukrainian TikTokers have made it a mission to share information and spread awareness with Western audiences. One of them is 20-year-old Marta Vasyuta. Shortly before the start of the Russian invasion, Marta traveled to London. She hasn't been able to go back to Ukraine since.
When I posted this first video, not even at the beginning, but a couple hours later, it had like 20,000 of views, which was really, really insane amount. And when it reached like 20 million views, I was like, that is the half of my country's population.
Marta follows multiple Telegram channels to find news and videos. She says she exercises due diligence in verifying the images and videos before posting them. Researchers warn that false information about the conflict is now mixed in with authentic information and has spread wildly on TikTok and other tech platforms. Alina says she's been posting videos to combat misinformation in the Russian news.
I think the role of young people in this conflict is firstly to refute the Russian propaganda, because a majority of Russians don't believe what is going on in Ukraine. I receive a lot of messages on my Instagram of support to Ukrainian people, and I really believe in bright future of all Ukrainian people.
In other news, a Cebu Pacific plane has been involved in a runway accident at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Terminal 3. Let's get more details from our correspondent, Jackie Manabat. Jackie?
The Cebu Pacific flight DG6112 had a slight runway excursion at Naia Tuesday morning. The flight originated at Naga, and upon landing at Naia, it had this slight runway excursion. It resulted to almost 2 hours of stop operations at the airport. All 42 passengers and four crew deplaned are safe with no reported injuries, according to Cebu Pacific management. They also add that passengers are being looked after and cared for. The involved Airbus is being towed away from the Naia runway, which this part of runway accommodates the wide-body flights. That is why some of the incoming flights using this particular runway had to be diverted to Clark, such as flights from Saigon and Cagayan and Iloilo, while some flights are experiencing delays, such as flights to London, to Dammam, to Dubai, and to Doha. Other local flights will also be delayed or will experience delays due to the runway congestion, and these are flights from Cebu, Davao, and Tagbilaran. Denise, so far we're still that's the information we have, and we are still getting more information from the airline and the airport. Denise?
Thanks for that report, Jackie. We're taking a quick break. Coming up, a lawyer who handled the 2016 election protest of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos against Vice President Lenny Robredo tapped as a Philippine poll body commissioner. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC Rundown. Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte appoints new officials to fill vacancies at the Commission on Elections. Duterte named former National Commission on Muslim Filipinos chairperson Saidaman Pangurungan as the new COMELEC chairman. The president also appointed former Social Welfare and Development Undersecretary Amy Torrefranca Neri and veteran election lawyer George Garcia as new COMELEC commissioners. Malacañang denies there's conflict of interest following the appointment of Garcia, who handled the 2016 poll protest of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos against Vice President Lenny Robredo.
Dapat respetuhin natin ang prerogative ng Pangulo na pumili ng opisyal. Again, hindi naman ito basta-basta lang na pinipili. Napakahabang proseso at merong mga vetting process. You know, it's not easy to choose an appointee na tatagal sa isang quasi-judicial independent body like the COMELEC.
The COMELEC has been operating with only four commissioners since last month, following the retirement of Antonio Co, Rowena Guanzon, and Sheriff Abbas. The allegations being thrown at the campaign of Vice President Lenny Robredo are proof the camp of her rival, Bongbong Marcos, is in panic mode. Over the weekend, Cavite Representative Buing Remulla alleged those who attended a huge campaign rally for Robredo in his home province were paid. Senatorial aspirant Neri Colmenares believes Remulla's accusations were an attack from the Marcos camp.
The way they're attacking VP Lenny now is a sign of panic within the Marcos camp dahil may momentum si VP Lenny Robredo. But ganito na lang. Kung gusto niyong manalo si VP Lenny, si Marcos Cavite, then you campaign for Bongbong Marcos. Do not resort to allegations na unfounded allegations.
An update now on the campaign trail. Presidential candidate Leody de Guzman and his running mate Owalden Bello were in Quezon City for a rally marking International Women's Day. They touted themselves as the only tandem pushing for concrete measures to protect women, such as the legalization of divorce and the decriminalization of abortion. Bongbong Marcos and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio bring their campaign to the vote-rich province of Bulacan. The pair vowed to continue the Duterte administration's Build, Build, Build program and its Peace and Order initiatives. Meanwhile, Aksyon Demokratiko standard-bearer Manila Mayor Isko Moreno and his running mate Dr. Willie Ong are wooing voters in Tarlac. They were greeted warmly by supporters when they stopped by a shopping center in the town of Concepcion earlier today. Moreno and Ong will also have a media event at the Tarlac provincial capital before holding a campaign rally this afternoon. In other news, the Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries has no control over the events leading to the run-up in global oil prices. That's according to OPEC's Secretary General, Mohammad Barkindo. He says OPEC remains committed to market stability. But he warns there is not enough capacity worldwide to compensate for the loss of Russian supply. OPEC and its allies have refused to increase output despite the worsening impact of the conflict between Russia and Ukraine on the global oil market.
We are facing what is likely to be a global game changer in terms of the energy transition, recovering from the pandemic, which had seen the energy markets, oil in particular, in an unprecedented disequilibrium in 2020. We have to overcome this crisis. We are in support. Our governments are working with other governments to play their own part in literally bringing back the wall on the rails, because we are derailed, unfortunately, so that peace and stability will be restored to enable us to face other challenges, because this is not the only one we are facing. Our industry, the oil industry in particular, as I have said elsewhere, is under siege. It's under siege.
Russia is one of the world's largest oil exporters, shipping around 7 million barrels per day. Here in the Philippines, the Energy Department sees another oil price hike happening next week. Attorney Rino Abad of the Oil Industry Management Bureau says a rollback is unlikely at this point in time, given the OPEC's refusal to increase oil production, thinning inventory, and the ongoing conflict between Russia and Ukraine.
We are inclined to say na baka sa susunod na linggo talagang mataas kagaya pa rin ngayon. Yung kasing taas pa rin ngayon ang mangyayaring adjustment. Habang hindi nababago yung apat na yun na sinabi ko, ini-expect po talaga natin, unfortunately, na tataas pa po ang price.
Legally speaking, Senator Franklin Drilon says there's no reason why the Finance Department cannot suspend the collection of fuel excise taxes as a form of relief for Filipinos. According to Drilon, the train law provides the DOF the elbow room it needs to adjust for when world crude prices exceed $80 a barrel. Before we go, ABS-CBN is calling for donations for Pantawid ng Pag-ibig campaign, where every 100 peso donation can feed a family in need during this COVID-19 pandemic. There are now more convenient ways to donate through our digital payment partners, Lazada and Shopee. Kindly prepare your mobile phone to donate via GCash. Just scan a QR code as seen on the screen. You can also donate through Paymaya and Cebuana Luwilier. And finally, the following peso and dollar accounts remain open to receive donations. Let us all contribute what we can. Together, our help can feed more Filipino families in need. Thank you for your generosity, Kapamilya. And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Dinsai. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.